Hi, these are the top 10 films of 1962. When I say top 10, I mean my personal favorite films of 1962. It's the coronavirus season and it's week, I don't know what now, being locked inside. So anyway, let's get on with the list. In at number 10, The Miracle Worker. This touching film tells the true story of Anne Sullivan and Helen Keller. Anne Bancroft plays Sullivan, a tutor of blind children, who is brought in to a rich southern family to look after and teach blind and deaf daughter Helen Keller, played brilliantly by Patty Duke. The real story of Helen Keller is absolutely astonishing, and this film just sort of deals with Keller's education by Sullivan. The two lead actresses couldn't be better. The film doesn't shy away from showing just how tough it was for Keller to get her education. There's this astonishing, really long sequence where Keller is being taught table manners by Sullivan, and they're basically having a war in the dining room. Years later, Ade Edmondson and Rick Mayall would play Keller and Sullivan in Bottom. In at number 9, To Kill a Mockingbird. Based on Harper Lee's Pulitzer Prize-winning novel, To Kill a Mockingbird is one of the great screen adaptations of all time. And one of the real keys to the movie's success is the casting of Gregory Peck as Atticus Finch. This is the part he was born to play, and he plays it brilliantly. It's a great adaptation of an unbelievably good novel. In at number 8, Ride the High Country. This is probably Sam Peckinpah's first great movie. We follow two older, retired gunslingers. They have one sort of last mission, as it were, where they have to transport gold from this really tough mining town. There's a really good duel slash shootout where just groups of men point their guns and slowly walk at each other firing, and it's really exciting. While not as violent as some of Peckinpah's later westerns, it's a really good indicator of just how well he handles the genre and a good taste of what was to come, Peckinpah being such a wonderful filmmaker. In at number 7, Whatever Happened to Baby Jane? This psychological horror film is one of the funniest films I've ever seen. Bette Davis plays Baby Jane Hudson, a former child star who is completely faded from recognition, who is looking after her paraplegic sister, played by Joan Crawford. It's a really twisted film, and both actresses give wonderful performances, but Bette Davis is particularly mesmerizing as the absolutely terrifying former child star. When she sings the song, "I've written a letter to Daddy," it's so creepy.
A letter to Daddy, saying I love you.
The film is simultaneously scary and very funny. It's knowingly camp and over the top, and it revels in it. There's an added bit of joy as well, knowing that Davis and Crawford didn't get along and had this feud. Just a really, really odd film. In at number 6, Jules et Jim, Jules and Jim. This Truffaut film is absolutely groundbreaking, and he's trying so many different new things. He uses real footage from World War I, freeze frames, he has photographs just in the middle of the film, and a voiceover throughout it. And none of these tricks are actually at expense of the storyline. The film's about a love triangle. Jules and Jim both fall in love with a woman named Catherine. She's a larger-than-life person who does things her own way, and the film spans many years following their relationship. Usually voiceovers don't work, but there are some notable exceptions, and this is one of them, because the little insights we have to the characters are really touching. Both Jules and Jim have to go fight in World War I, and they're on opposing sides. And they use real footage from World War I. And it's a little like Peter Jackson's film, They Shall Not Grow Old, because they use this footage, but they've put audio over it and foleyed the sound. It's such a great film. It was very hard to know where to place it in the top 10. In fact, my top 10 was very difficult to place anyway, and there were a lot of films that didn't make it in that were amazing. It was a really strong year. It was a great year for samurai films. There was the wonderful Harakiri. There was also Kurosawa's follow-up to Yojimbo, Sanjuro. And the first two Zatoichi films, The Blind Samurai Monsieur Bloke, a very long-running franchise where the same actor played Zatoichi in 26 films. 1962 also had The Manchurian Candidate, which has some absolutely astounding sequences in it. Roman Polanski burst onto the scene with Knife in the Water, and James Bond made his feature film debut in Dr. No. Buñuel also released The Exterminating Angel, a film about a bunch of people who all of a sudden just can't leave the living room. It seems very apt for these times. In at number 5, An Autumn Afternoon. This was Ozu's last film, and it's one of his best. Ozu regular Shishu Ryo plays a businessman and a father who's starting to realise that maybe he should let his daughter marry and move away from home. And what we get is this wonderful, tender portrayal of a family and different parts of a family. His oldest son is married to a woman, and they're both quite materialistic and quite modern and sort of unhappy in their own ways. The film talks about loneliness in a really beautiful way. And we also see the lead character sort of, it's hinted and sort of shown that he's an alcoholic, and it's going to get worse when he's alone. And it's so subtly done, much more subtly done than Days of Wine and Roses, Blake Edwards' film about Jack Lemmon falling into alcoholism, which is very far from subtle.
I'll give you all the booze you want.
Ozu died soon after the release of this film on his 60th birthday, and it was a real loss to the world of cinema. He was never married and never had a family, which is astonishing considering just how well he could portray families on screen. Ozu was one of the best. In at number 4, The Man Who Shot Liberty Valance. While not having the visual majesty of something like The Searchers, The Man Who Shot Liberty Valance is John Ford's most personal and human western. The wonderful ensemble cast, including John Wayne, James Stewart, Vera Miles, and Lee Marvin, are all amazing, and each of them have their character journey and a real interesting dynamic with each other.
James Stewart plays a senator who comes to a small town in the west with his wife to pay respects to a man who's died. And the journalists in this small town are wondering, why are you this, you know, popular, famous senator coming here for a nobody, a funeral of a nobody? And through a series of flashbacks, we find out that it's John Wayne that the funeral is for. As a young man studying law, he arrives in this small town after being robbed and attacked by Liberty Valance, played brilliantly by Lee Marvin. John Wayne is a hard man in town who's in love with this woman played by Vera Miles. And really, the film then, how do you deal with a problem like Liberty Valance?
I'm going to stop doing that now. It just takes so long. It's a wonderful film about heroism and fables and history and how things change and how things are interpreted. And it's just so touching. It's my favourite performance of John Wayne. He's vulnerable in it as well as being very tough. And just each of these cast members playing their characters, it just all comes together so brilliantly. And it's actually probably my favourite John Ford Western. I really love The Man Who Shot Liberty Valance. In at number 3, Il Sorpasso. This Italian comedy is really unlike anything else. Jean-Louis Trintignant plays a student who's desperately trying to get some work done when he's interrupted by Vittorio Gassman, this loudmouth Italian who sort of does what he wants. They meet by complete chance, and all of a sudden this road trip across Italy begins. And it's absolutely riveting. Vittorio Gassman plays a character named Bruno, and he's always honking his horn and overtaking people and doing what he wants and getting into fights. And the rather sheepish, much more mild Roberto is sort of taken away with his confidence and wishes he could do that. There's these wonderful sequences where Roberto is thinking about what he's going to do next, and he makes these decisions. He goes, no, I'm going to get out of the car and I'm going to go home. And the moment the decision is to be made, he just goes with whatever is going on. It's a wonderful, truthful vision of a person. It's a really funny film, but also quite dark, because both the characters are tragic in their own ways. And as the film goes on, especially into its second half, we find out more about Bruno, and that things aren't exactly all roses on his side either. The two characters become friends, despite being so different. And it's touching and tragic and relatable and funny. Il Sorpasso is a great film.
Ah, vabbè, noi adesso tiriamo e tu spingi, eh? Forza, attaccatevi alla maniglia. Uno, due, tre! Ah, vabbè, non l'hai spinto. Spingi!
In at number two, Lolita. As the trailers and the poster would say, how did they ever make a film of Lolita? And it's a good question. And how did they ever make the film of Lolita so funny?
You know, I have a glorious surprise for us.
One of your dramatic suites?
Based on Nabokov's controversial yet excellent book, the film follows Humbert Humbert, a middle-aged college lecturer who moves to a small town in the US and becomes infatuated with a young girl. James Mason plays the pervert Humbert Humbert, and I think it's my favourite performance in anything ever. Mason is unbelievably good at playing Humbert Humbert's weakness. There's wonderful scenes where it's sort of like, he wants to go to a slumber party with them, so he's trying to convince the adults to go. It's like, it's really not a problem, is it, Charlotte?
I think we ought to come over and help.
Oh, no, what do you think of it, Humbert? No.
And it's this wonderful, tragic performance of a man sort of losing his mind and following his weakness and his wants.
Oh, well, that wasn't very clever of you.
Oh, dear.
It had to happen sometime.
Peter Sellers plays Humbert Humbert's rival pervert,
Quilty,
a rich pervert who's also after Lolita, and who puts on all these different voices and guises to confuse Humbert Humbert. Sue Lyon is perfect as Lolita, playing both the innocent qualities and also the very annoying qualities that come with youth. Shelley Winters is also brilliantly funny and tragic as Lolita's mother. Her love for James Mason is quite pathetic as well. There's a lot of patheticness in the film, and it's cringe-making, but so funny and very realistic. The second half of the film gets really dark as we follow his sort of descent into madness and obsession. Stanley Kubrick is just one of the great filmmakers, and he takes a great book and makes a very different but absolutely compelling film. I love Lolita, and James Mason's performance in it is my favourite performance in anything ever, except maybe for his advert for Thunderbird wine.
I like the unusual flavour of Thunderbird wine. It's an exceptionally good drink for every occasion. Thunderbird has an unusual flavour all its own, not quite like anything I've ever tasted. I suggest that you try Thunderbird. It's really delightful.
And in at number one, Lawrence of Arabia. Wow. Lawrence of Arabia is something else. David Lean's epic about T.E. Lawrence's activities in Arabia in World War I is filmmaking at its highest standard. Visually, it's arresting and astonishing and beautiful and, again, unbelievably good. The score is rousing and emotional and completely sweeps you away. The performances are touching, heartfelt, exciting, real. The editing is on point and remarkable. And David Lean directs this 3-hour plus epic with such gusto and such control that the time just flies past. There are heartbreaking scenes in it. There are epic scenes that, you know, make your eyes pop out. Every aspect of the filmmaking is at the highest possible quality. It's a miraculous film. There are not enough positive adjectives to describe Lawrence of Arabia. It's a masterpiece. It's amazing. It's one of the greatest films of all time. So, counting down the top 10. In at number 10, The Miracle Worker. In at number 9, To Kill a Mockingbird. In at number 8, Ride the High Country. In at number 7, Whatever Happened to Baby Jane. In at number 6, Jules et Jim. Jules and Jim. In at number 5, An Autumn Afternoon. In at number 4, The Man Who Shot Liberty Valance. In at number 3, Il Sorpasso. In at number 2, Lolita. And in at number 1, Lawrence of Arabia. Well, that was my top 10 films of 1962. What are your top 10 films of 1962?
Cheers.